And Patty, it's a wonderful crowd we have today. I've been involved with Rotary for a long time, 20, 30 years, can't keep track of it, and I don't recall a crowd quite this size, even though we've had some extraordinary speakers. So this is quite a testimony to our speaker today. One of the great joys I have as a program chair is helping identify the incredible resources of our area and our club. I love leading looking into the history of the York area, the incredible businesses and leaders that we have. And most fun for me is introducing our club's membership to the diamonds and jewels in our community that many times we are not even aware of. Our speaker is certainly one of the crown jewels of York. And one of our committee members worked diligently for more than 2 years to bring this program about, for the speaker is a tremendously busy person. In fact, he'll be leaving here today to fly overseas for a week. While many in this room know of his work, many others will be shocked and hopefully a little inspired that world-renowned artist Jeff Koons, the highest producing living artist, hails from York County. And even those who know of Jeff may be shocked at the breadth and the scope of his body of work. Jeff was born and raised here in York County. Some of his fellow Dover classmates are down in the front here to keep him honest and sincere. And he went to Dover and he studied at the Maryland Institute of College of Art in Baltimore, and my understanding is he commuted sometimes with Suzanne Klein. He also then went off to the School of Art Institute in Chicago. Since his first solo exhibit in 1980, Jeff's work has been shown in major galleries and institutions throughout the world. And when I say throughout the world, I mean if you look at the list of where his shows have been, it's probably 60, 80, 90 museums long. It's impressive. I first remember learning about Jeff not through local lore, but in reading the Wall Street Journal article on Hanging Harp in the 1990s and 2000s, and later another article described Hanging Harp as the highest paid transaction at $23.6 million for a living artist's work. It set a record at that time. Somewhere along the lines, I realized that Jeff Koons, that I'd been reading about, was actually from York, and it made me incredibly proud. Koons is known for his public sculptures, and as mentioned, Jeff is widely known as producing works that have sold for some of the highest prices by a living artist, including the $58.4 million balloon dog sculpture, happened to be the orange one, and he continues to set records virtually every year. Jeff recently offered a gift to the French people following a terrorist attack, producing a bronze, stainless steel, and aluminum sculpture called Bouquet of Tulips. As you can imagine, Jeff has received many, many, many awards, and both domestically and international honors. It is very lengthy, and I won't take the time to go through them. There have been thousands of articles written about Jeff and his work, and just know that people think he's incredible. Jeff lives and works in New York City, but he spends significant amounts of time in York County on his farm, and actually commutes to New York City in the summertime when his family can be more local. He lives there with his wife Justine and their 6 children. Fellow Rotarians and guests, I would ask for a please warm welcome for our friend Jeff Koons.
Thank you very much. It's an honor to be here in front of the Rotary Club and President Patty. Thank you very much. And First Lady Francis, what an honor that you're here today. And my friends from high school, it's so wonderful to have this group together. But I'm going to give a little overview of my life. I don't know if we want to bring the lights down a little bit to do that, or to do them as they are.
You won't need to.
Okay.
You'll be okay.
But, you know, sometimes I really have to pinch myself that the type of platform that I've been able to have within my life, and to be able to make my artworks, and to be able to have the opportunity to have them be shown. I started off, my father is an interior decorator, and Henry J. Koons Interiors is on East Market Street, right down from the York Historical Society. And this is the showroom, a window of my father's store. And my father was the first to show my paintings. And so I would make works after school or in school, and my father would show them in the window. And so there are a couple works that are here in York County. Several of them are based on old master paintings. So my parents really gave me a sense of confidence. I have one sibling, my sister Karen, and she's 3 years older. And so, she could always do everything better than I could. She could count further, she could pronounce words better. She had this little age advantage. But finally, one time, I was making a drawing, and I was probably around 4 years of age, and I remember my parents coming up and really kind of patting me on the back and saying, this is really great, Jeff, this is nice. And I finally had a sense of self. And, that's why I'm here today. And, we all get this type of support in different areas of our life, but when we can share that with people and to give them a sense of being and uniqueness in the world and give them a sense of being, that can really make a big difference. So my parents continued that. I started to take lessons from the age of 7. There was a woman named Mrs. Ames that was here in the community, so I would study with her on the weekends. And my grandfather, the farm that Michael just mentioned that we have in Red Line, that was my grandfather's farm, and he sold it in 59. I was 4 years of age, but he had Mrs. Ames paint a mural on his kind of den wall of his new home. And so this is the woman then that I started to study with. I would always be in art school. I'd be there with Sue Ann and some of my other friends, with Rochelle. And I wanted to go to college, but I really wasn't prepared to go and study anything else. I mean, within liberal arts, I didn't really focus on mathematics. When it came time for college, the only thing that I was prepared for was art. So I went to the Maryland Institute College of Art in Baltimore. This is another image of myself in York with my sister Karen and my mother and my grandmother. My grandfather, Ralph Sitter, my mother's father, was city treasurer at one time in York. And so I always grew up with a sense of being connected to the community. My other grandfather, Clayton Koons, he drove the trolley car that went to Brookside Park, and as a matter of fact, in the York Industrial Museum, that trolley car that was redone was the one that my grandfather used to drive. And so there was always he would interact with people every day, so there's always a sense of an understanding that participating in your community is really important. My mother's father, all of his brothers, my uncles, they were all merchants in the community. This is the shoe house, and the shoe house always had a big impact, this type of fantasy architecture. And I would remember when we would go to Philadelphia, we'd drive by and I'd see the shoe house. So I've incorporated these aspects of growing up into my work. And this is Philadelphia. I feel so lucky. If you look at the state of Pennsylvania, Pennsylvania's produced a lot of really talented artists. You have Andy Warhol, Keith Haring, the Wyeths, you have the Peels, you have the Calders. And it's because there's a tremendous, there's this sense of connectivity where you're connected to the past, to history. The whole name Philadelphia is based on philanthropy and having responsibility to each other, to your community. When I was a child, to go to the farm show complex or to the York Fair, these are fantastic opportunities to stimulate people. And going up to the top of William Penn was really moving for me. My aunt, Aunt Erna, lived in Philadelphia, and she took me up there as a child, maybe I was about 9. But what a moving experience, because when you go to the top, the architecture around the dome, right underneath William Penn's feet, it's like Jules Verne type architecture. You can imagine like Journey to the Center of the Earth or Journey to the Moon, all these steel kind of beams and rivets. And then you look out over the city and you have this sense of history and the awe and wonderment of this huge sculpture, 75-foot tall, big bronze sculpture. These are the experiences that Pennsylvania had to offer. And that experience is as great and as wonderful as being beside like Michelangelo's David or the Pieta. Because the experience, it's about what it brings to you, your own sense of possibility in your life. You know, growing up, I would drive around and I would see inflatables around Easter time. Back in the 60s, early 70s, people would put these inflatables in their yard. So after art school, and in art school, I started to study art history. And I felt so lucky that in art school, I realized in my first art history class that art so effortlessly connects all the human disciplines. And I could be a dilettante. I could have a little involvement in philosophy, a little involvement in psychology and aesthetics and theology and all the human disciplines. That's really the beauty of art, that it does that so effortlessly. Now, any profession, if you really focus on your interests, it always can take you to that hub, but art does it very effortlessly. In 1978, I started to make these inflatable pieces. This is inflatable bunny with flower. Again, I was thinking about my experiences, because the only thing you have in life are your own interests. And you know, you have your interests, you can focus on those interests, and if you trust in yourself, focus on your interests, it always takes you to a very metaphysical place where you connect with the universal, and time and space bend there, and you really are able to connect to, I think, human history and be able to put your foot a little bit in the future. But I think that I started to connect when I was making pieces like the inflatable rabbit. I would buy just store-bought mirrors, like for a hardware store, place these objects on them, and when you'd move around it, it would affirm you. It would affirm that what's happening is happening inside you. The reflection of the rabbit shifts and the flower and this type of abstraction only occurs within you. That's always where the art is. The art's not in that object, that sculpture, that image. It's inanimate. But the art is your sense of your own potential, your own excitement about your own future. That's art. That's what's of value. Nothing else has value. Around 1980, I wanted to continue to have a dialogue with the idea of the ready-made, about things really accessible. I remember when I first went to the Baltimore Museum of Art, my first day of art school, I realized I didn't know anything. Now, my aunt took me to the Philadelphia Museum when I was 7, but when I went to the museum, I did not know my first day of college. I didn't know Braque, I didn't know Cezanne, I didn't know Matisse. I mean, I would have known Picasso and Dali, and that would have been about it. And I felt like I survived that moment. And Sue Ann went to the same school, and I remember they would tell us that look around, and you know, 3 years from now, 75% of the people won't be there, and then the last year, like another 10% will go. And a lot of people don't survive that. And art can be something that can completely disempower you, and you feel like you don't have enough information to be involved with it. I wanted to play football. My dad never played football. I went to try out for the team. I was cut within 10 minutes because I wasn't prepared. I couldn't participate. Well, people feel like art can be that way, and it isn't. Because you're always perfect. Your own cultural history is perfect. Everything about you to that moment is perfect. It's just about you and your own interests and where that can take you. Here, I wanted the confrontation between objects, kind of a philosophical thing about really who's better prepared for the eternal, who's more immortal. And so the object, I'm just displaying the newness. These vacuum cleaners are brand new, and they don't have their most integrity by participating, by non-participation they have it, and of course, as individuals, we have our integrity by participating. This is a triple-decker. This would also be around 1980. So there's a sense of family unit there, almost like Papa Bear, Mama Bear, and Baby Bear. But if you look at the side of the vacuum cleaners, it says wet-dry. and it's a Shelton wet dry vacuum cleaner. But the wet dry, I was really interested in either or, being and nothingness, and dealing with Kierkegaard and with Sartre, existentialism, and also at the same time playing with philosophy. After working and making the vacuum cleaner pieces, I wanted to make work that was more biological. I wanted to be free from the objects, because these objects, I was keeping everything clean and pristine, everything had to be perfect. And so I wanted something more biological, so I decided to take a more analytical look at consumerism, and I wanted to deal with physics, so I had this idea of, you know, removing basically a vacuum cleaner from an enclosed space. And I put a basketball, and I just have it hovering there in equilibrium. And so that ball is just hovering. It's too light to sink to the bottom, but too heavy to go to the top. I called Dr. Richard P. Feynman, the Nobel Prize winner, and I wanted permanent equilibrium. So he worked with me, and he'd tell me, Jeff, you can do it. And I would push, but it was impossible within the confines of an aquarium. The density gradient is... It's too small of an area, even with the most compressible liquid on Earth. Silicon oil, I'd need a tank about 100 feet tall. But he pushed, and it was a really great experience. So this is only temporary equilibrium. It'll last for about 6 months, and then it goes to the bottom of the tank. But it's like an embryo. It's like pre-birth, and it's also like after death. So it's very metaphysical stuff. This was a tool for equilibrium. It was a ready-made. I've always worked with ready-mades, again, about this accessibility, that everything around you is perfect in its own being. And this all, everything's a metaphor for people, because we really don't care about objects. We care about ourselves and each other. So everything's a metaphor for people. But this is a bronze aqualung, and this was a tool for equilibrium. If somebody wanted to achieve that state of entropy and this ultimate kind of state of being, if they put this on their back, it would take them under, and it would probably drown you unless you could get it off and somehow get to the surface. After working with bronze in 1986, I made my rabbit. And the rabbit was one of 10 different works. I started showing with Ileana Sonnabend, an amazing historic woman that bridged Europe and the United States together with art. She showed Andy Warhol and Jasper Johns and Bob Rauschenberg in Paris, while her husband, Leo Castelli, would show them in New York. And so I showed this the first time when I started working with Ileana. And I gave a panoramic view of art, how art works in different areas. I made these trolls as mythology, I made the Italian woman as art as beauty, I had the rabbit as art as fantasy. But I was really thinking about the yards in Pennsylvania. And I was thinking about the gazing ball. And if you look at the head of the rabbit, it's a circular gazing ball. In 1987, I was invited to be in an exhibition in Germany. It happens only once every 10 years. And I chose to recast the sculpture in the town square. And it's called a kip and curl. And this, again, is tied to my roots, because the kip and curl is from an agrarian culture. He has a kip on his back, a basket, and it has eggs, potatoes, hams, tobacco, pigeons. And it's really this kind of sense of self-sufficiency. I cast it and I put it in mirrored stainless steel to try to show that this idea of having one's needs met has shifted and it's changed a little bit from the past, but still making reference to the sense of self-reliance. In 88, I made a body of work called Banality, and kind of my philosophical approach on art about everybody's background being perfect, cultural background perfect, and it's all about this moment forward. I believe I started to articulate the best at this time. This is called Ushering in Banality. I always thought this is a little autobiographical. I thought of that as myself pushing this pig from the back. And it was that I really didn't care what people thought, that I felt that at least I had like a supernatural kind of God's will on my side in ushering in banality. And I worked with wood which is a very, it's a living material, so it's involved. You think of transcendence, the way the churches work with wood. All the wood carvers that would carve these saints and the little Henri figures and little Humboldt figurines were the carvers for these works. I made in northern Italy. And then I also worked in porcelain. And porcelain, because it was a very regal material, and an essential material, it shrinks 19% in the oven. And it came from the king's kitchen. Only an emperor or a king would have porcelain. But today it's completely democratized. We all can have porcelain. This is an ashtray that was my grandfather and grandmother's, Ralph and Mel Sipper. And so when I was a kid and I would go to their home on Queen Street, you know, I would just sit down and I'd play with this ashtray and I'd move that woman's legs back and forth with my finger and I would move the fan. And, you know, working with porcelain comes from this experience. You know, again, the type of joy and wonder that I found playing with this ashtray, it's equivalent to any other kind of higher type of level of work, whether it's a Bernini sculpture or whatever it could be. You can't justify and say that one, that there's a hierarchy, that one is better than the other. There is no hierarchy. It's about the stimulation, the excitement, the sense of future, the understanding, the awe and wonderment. Now this piece, this little ashtray, I know that when I made this work, I was really thinking about that ashtray. And if you look at it, it's really the same thing. That's woman in the tub. But you still have that kind of circular area that maybe where the legs would have been, but now it's the tub itself, and you have this woman. And again, it's just embracing my own cultural history. I mean, I can't embrace your cultural history. I can't embrace anybody else's. I have my own, and that's what we have in our life. And if we focus on our interests and we accept ourselves, we realize that information is so abundant around us. And everything that you're kind of interested in and curious about, you can see that it's everywhere. This is a puppy. I made this in 1992. This is in front of a Schloss in Germany. But it's made out of 60,000 live growing plants. And I wanted to make a piece that was really about control and giving up control and about power, you know, wanting to exercise power and giving up power and all of these type of polarities that take place. And within Baroque art, you have the symmetrical and the asymmetrical. You have the eternal through mathematics and thought and ideas, and you have the eternal through biology. And so to bring all of these different types of polarities together, I think that what puppy deals with. And the life cycle, you look at it and you realize you always have a sense of mortality, but there are 60,000 decisions there. Each plant, each color is a decision. This is Split Rocker. This is the shoe house. I mean, to me, I wanted to create my own shelter. Puppy's a little bit like that, because you can go inside puppy and it's like there's a ladder going all the way up the top. It's like going up a church a ladder, or going up to the top of William Penn in a way. But this has skylights the top, and you walk in the front, you could go out the back. But it was like a fantasy of a child's shelter. This is at Versailles. This is my balloon dog. I started my balloon dog around 1994. I finished and was able to deliver the first one around 2000. To be able to bring a surface to a very, very high reflective surface and to maintain all the details was a little more difficult than I thought. So it took a little more time to be able to achieve it, but we've continued to push the technology absolutely on the far cutting edge. I partnered with MIT with Bits and Atoms. And so I'm always working with them and using white light scan, but also CAT scans and everything, and working with my models and to be able to work as efficiently as possible. These pieces, the reflective surface, again, is to affirm you that when you walk around, that it's all about you. It's about, you know, if you're not in the room, it doesn't exist. It's a little bit like a Trojan horse. It has kind of an interior life to it also. This is a painting called Play-Doh, and there's a mound of Play-Doh there, and behind it I have a very reflective surface. This would be from around 1996. But I have a son named Ludwig, and I was visiting Ludwig. My son was abducted, a parental abduction, and so I was a left-behind parent, and when I go visit him, I'd always bring, you know, Play-Doh and drawing the toys and pens and everything. So one day, you know, he pulled out the Play-Doh and he did something. He said, "Dad," and I looked over and he had a mound of Play-Doh in front of him. And he went, and voila! And, you know, he was so proud of this mound of Play-Doh that, you know, and I looked at it and I thought, this is what I'm trying to do every day of my life as an artist, to make something that you can't make any judgments about. And so I went back, I made a mound of Play-Doh, and I made a sculpture, and I also made a painting. This is a lobster. I always thought the lobster is a little bit like a circus performer. You don't, you know, the role goes back and forth of who's performing and who's actually observing. And it's referencing Salvador Dali. Dali was a big influence and was kind enough to meet me when I was 18. And, you know, with the mustache, is like Dali's mustache, and also a reference to Marcel Duchamp putting the mustache on the Mona Lisa, L-H-O-O-Q. This is Popeye, a stainless steel piece. It comes from a small little toy. I always think of my father and his generation with Popeye. But, you know, Popeye would say, you know, I am what I am. And I always like this about self-acceptance. This is a painting from the Antiquity series. And, you know, my work, I made a piece in a celebration called Diamond. It looks like a big bling type of diamond with four posts on the side. But to me, that isn't about bling, but it's about the moment of creation. And the posts that are on the side of the diamond are actually kind of male energy, and it's like the egg, all of a sudden life unfolding, all the facets of life unfolding at the moment of creation. And as far back as you can go in the point of the diamond, as far back as you can go in human history. And so it, to me, it's the narrative, the most authentic narrative of the true human history, the genes and the DNA. So the paintings and all the artwork from this time of antiquity are always dealing with a lot of connectivity, of making different references, going back through time. This is the actress Gretchen Mol. I photographed her for New York Times magazine, but I have her posed here as like an Aphrodite. And instead of arrows, she has this inflatable monkey. She's on a dolphin. The sheet behind her is from Raphael Peel, a Pennsylvanian artist. But that I made it transparent, and you look through that onto this background of this painting I found on the street, which is referencing Courbet. But Peel was also referencing Salvador Dali's last work, The Swallow's Tale. And so there are just many, many layers of references. This is a porcelain that I made into a stainless steel piece called Metallic Venus. And this incorporates live plants in that vase. This is a reference to Praxiteles. You don't have to know anything about art history. You know, when I first walked around this piece, I thought Led Zeppelin, "Hey, Hey, Mama." You don't have to know anything about art history. But it's just, you know, the type of connectivity, it's the way our genes and our DNA connect in our internal biological life, in our exterior world, our cultural lives, and our interactions with people are paralleling and making the same connectivity. This is on Palazzo Signorina in Florence, and it's beside Michelangelo's David. This is Pluto and Proserpina. This was the first artwork in 500 years since David, Michelangelo's David was installed there, that work was installed in this location in Florence. But wait, I have to pinch myself. I'm not saying it for that, but I have to pinch myself, because everything we've talked about York County, we've talked about Pennsylvania, my grandfather's ashtray, it comes from all these type things, and everything is so accessible. I'm here today only because I've always wanted to participate. And, you know, that's it. I moved to New York. I sat around with my friends. We would drink beer. We would talk about what we want art to be. And I just wanted to participate. So when anybody ever gave me an opportunity, I would say yes. And this is my seated ballerina. And my seated ballerina is part of the antiquity series, but really affected my newer work because it's based on a porcelain like a Meissen porcelain, all the type of gradations that you have where the hands could be a little warmer with pigment, or the elbows could have a little more color, a little more pigment, or the gradations on the dresses. I'm able to capture that and scanning it and have the same type of gradations transparent on my stainless steel. So it gives another metaphysics to it, because I always define metaphysics as the right here, right now, and the eternal. And so gradation is really depicting time. It's like a sunrise or a sunset. So it just brings one more level of time in communicating that to people. This is another ballerina figure. I always think that the one ballerina having her hands in this type of position, it's just kind of referencing everything. This is a gazing bowl sculpture, a bird bath. I always believe that my grandmother had a bird bath in the backyard. My mother says she didn't, but I always feel like there was a bird bath. These are made out of plaster. I worked with the Metropolitan Museum with George Wheeler, and we created a plaster that looks identical to pottery plaster, exactly like it, but this is stronger and more durable than marble. And this whole dialogue, you would start with, you know, a little bird bath, and I had mailboxes, and I had different images that were utilitarian and related to art. But then you would end up in this exhibition with something like the Farnese Hercules, which this would be going from like one voice or two voice to like maybe 5,000 people kind of having a discussion, 5,000 people having a discussion about transcendence or kind of enlightenment. This is gazing bowl painting. This is Rubens, the tiger hunt. And so all the paintings are also making, I mean, it's kind of my DNA, the type of images that I chose to work with. But the gazing bowl affirms you, reflects you, then the reflects the painting. So you enter into the painting and you're able to go back into time through the painting. And all the references that the artist is making and giving it up. You know, the only way really to kind of achieve a sense of transcendence is to give it up through love of something else, finding something greater than the self. So Rubens is thinking about Leonardo, and in this painting he's referencing the Battle of Angarhari. And the Battle of Angarhari, you have this kind of cross taking place of the men on the horseback. And so he's making references to different artists. This is Leonardo, this is the Mona Lisa. Now I know I probably went way over my 20 minutes, I want to open things up and we can have a conversation and talk about things. I'm making a new series of work, I'm calling them porcelains, even though they're not, they're going to be just outdoor garden sculptures. So I'm really as excited today as I was 40 years ago when I kind of moved to New York and started to get a little traction. And when I was younger, Sue Ann, when we'd go to college, we'd come home for like 3 months over the summer. And it was always a little hard to do your artwork over the summer. You'd have a job, make some money to get back into school. So when September would come around and you'd start painting again, it was kind of like starting a car up, you know. It would be, I'm going to start to paint. What do I paint? I have no idea what to paint. And you try, and you don't feel anything. There's no feeling. There's no sensation. So then you try another painting. Okay, maybe there's little, you feel a little more interested in this. It has a little more reason for being. And you keep going, and all of a sudden you feel, oh, you know what? This has a reason for being. It has to be about your own focus, focusing on what your interests are. And it's like starting that car, you know, whoop, doesn't turn over. So you do it again, whoop, 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 whoop. And then finding, whoop, 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 whoop. And, you know, by your fourth painting or so, you have it going. And that's how it is in art. That's how it is in every aspect of our life if we just follow our interests. And what, you know, what could be more kind of joyful? What else do we have other than our interests? And it never fails. It doesn't fail me with the idea of excitement and possibility that I feel with my work. And I've never seen it fail, anybody around me that also kind of just moves full force with their interests. So, you know, I want to thank you just for having the opportunity to speak to the club, but I'd love to, you know, interact if there are any questions. And yes?
What is your favorite medium?
Hey, if you have a question, could you stand up in a large room like this?
I'm just curious, you've worked with a lot of different mediums. What is the favorite? What's the like to work?
You know, I think my family. It's completely abstract, but I mean, I really love family life, and I like interacting with my children, and I enjoy the type of life we create together. Now, that's a very abstract kind of answer. It's all the same to me, whether it's a painting or a sculpture. I like sculpture because I feel that it has kind of a double whammy to it. It's, you know, it's confrontational. It's right here. It confronts your body. So I'm attracted to sculpture, but anything that can communicate an idea, I'm most known for sculpture. Yes, First Lady? Francis.
I've been lucky enough to see some of your pieces in the flesh, and I'm intrigued by the scale, the choices that you've made in sort of creating the scale. Can you talk about how you choose a scale? I mean, there's a huge difference between making, you know, one of the porcelain pieces this big or this. And I was just wondering if you could talk about the process. What you think about it?
Yes. Francis' his question was about scale, like, you know, why would maybe I make some pieces this size, other pieces larger, what type of considerations for scale? You know, Plato would say the first thing that you deal with in art is scale. And it's true, whenever you start with an idea, how are you going to present it, it's what size it'll be. What's interesting right now, VR has a lot of it's wonderful. I'm using that to size my new sculptures so that I would make maybe if I'm going to make a sculpture, a cardboard cutout or something kind of rough, just to give an idea of a presence in space. But now with VR, you can just, you know, okay, you have something this big, and okay, I'm going to make it bigger, 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 and you can just scale it. But everything has its own sense, its own perception for communication of what it should be. You just have to listen to that. And, you know, an eighth of an inch can make a huge difference. Yes?
What project are you working on now?
You know, I'm always working on different things. As was mentioned, a sculpture called Bouquet of Tulips I'm making for France right now. We'll unveil that in the summer. I'm working on a whole new series of work. I have 18 new sculptures that I have in progress. It'll probably be 2.5 years before I can have an exhibition of those works. So I always have to keep a lot of things going because there's a long wait period for some of these things to be delivered. I've been working on ballerinas, made carved out of marble for the last 5 years now. The pieces will take about 8 years each. When I say each, the first ones are taking 8 years of ballerinas. They're larger than life. They're about 100 foot tall, but they're lace, and it's all carved out of marble, and really probably the most elaborate works carved.
Do you have anything for York?
No, yes. it would be very, very nice. And there a lot of considerations have to go into it, where something could be that it can, because even though the pieces can be in steel and everything, the surfaces aren't always as durable as you'd like them to be in a kind of a public situation. But I think it would be wonderful someday to be able to have a piece in York. It would be great. So.
Yeah.
Yes.
How many close
How many close associates do you have working with you at any point in time? I suspect you don't do this all yourself. How
do you tell us a little
about that?
Yeah, you know, I used to do everything myself until around 19, well, when I made my banality works, or even prior to that, when I started casting, I realized when I go to a foundry, they would make the waxes for me, and there would be certain facilities that you just wouldn't do, that anybody working at a foundry would always entrust them to do the pouring or the casting or work on the waxes. So I started to be more comfortable working with people. And then when I worked in Italy, making the wood carvings and the porcelains, but I would always, I'm responsible for everything. So I'm on top of everything. I follow all the different details, because the reason for those details is to show and to try to gain the trust of the viewer and to show them that what you really care about is them. You don't care about the object. You want them to maintain the abstraction for as long as possible. So you're really trying to pay attention to them and to communicate to them that you care about them. That's the reason for all the dedication to details. But in the city, I have about 140 people, and then I have Antiquity Stone. I think we have about 29 people. In Germany, there are about 100 people that work on my sculptures every day. One more question.
I know you had spoken about different goals you were trying to achieve as an artist of expression and non-judgment. Do you feel you've reached that, or do you always feel it's something elusive that you haven't accomplished yet?
Well, you know, I feel like I haven't done anything. So I really would like to achieve something. I'd like to walk out of Plato's cave. I'd like to really have a greater sense of enlightenment and transcendence. That's what I strive for every day, to try to really do something. And you know, I'm so grateful for the platform I have, and you know, it's up to me to do it. So I don't take it for granted, so I'm trying to push myself every day. You know, I really want to thank everybody. It's my relative there, Stephanie. Sorry.
I just wanted to thank you for your sense of personal generosity. Oftentimes you talk about being a little York County boy and driving along and seeing the inflatables and the ladies' bottoms that were in gardens. And you, I think at one point you said you saw that as a kind of a generosity. Art or whomever, even a person's essence being offered in a visible way to those who would drive by. What I'm going to say is that I think you've shown a kind of integrity in that, in the way you've been living your life. And so I thank you for the wonderful farms that you bought in York County, where you're trying to preserve rural life. And even restoring Uncle Ralph's farm, which was a source of great delight for many of us. And I thank you for calling us to examine these icons that are part of our lives. And I don't think we only see them as iconographic. You know, when I look at your vacuum cleaner, while it still boggles my mind, is how you did it, or maybe why you needed to do it. I know in my heart that my Aunt Nell and my mother had a kind of reverence for their vacuum cleaners and the kind of cleanliness that they, and order that they could create. Basketball, think about the billions of dollars that are generated around athletics. So I think, you know, once we start thinking a little bit, looking at the idea of these great, huge, wonderful mirror surfaces that say to us, you're important, your presence in this hall, reflecting in this rabbit or whatever, is of significance. I think that's very important. I think sometimes we need to hear that in a non-super, I'm the only one who counts way. We live in such a frenetic and hectic and threatened feeling world. Perhaps it's a really good thing to be able to say, even my reflection in this piece of art, in that reflection ball, matters. So I just want to say thank you.
Stephanie, thank you. Stephanie, I could have had you up here the whole time. Thank you very, very much.